One. As you all know, we are in the middle of a serious war. Bezrat Hashem, when the war will be over, we hope that there will be, that the job will get done, not like 2 years ago. We already have been in this movie, and we're back to square one. To do 60-70% of the job and leave it, it's a complete waste of time. The Arabs have no problem getting money. They have thousands of workers, many thousands, $100 million from Qatar, many millions from Saudis, Iran. Money, it's not a problem. Workers, anyway, they're all unemployed, so they have to work in terrorism. So for them, it's actually fun. They just got work for the next year or two. If you don't clean the cancer from a person's body 100%, only 80%, it grows back. What was the whole surgery for? You started, they say in Hebrew, "Amatchil b'mitzvah omrim lo gmor." This is milchemet mitzvah. Milchemet mitzvah. If you don't finish the job, we can cry for it forever. I hope the government would learn the lesson from 2 years ago. Somehow, unfortunately, I'm afraid that if tomorrow they'll offer them a ceasefire, they'll jump on it kemotze shalal rav. Why? Because they go with their heart, not with the head. And their heart is crying because there are 30 dead soldiers. And because of the pain in the heart, the fear to turn the news on, we all have it, I'm sure. When you turn your computer on and you try to read the news, your hands are shaking. Who knows what happened in the last 3, 4 hours or 5 hours. But I'm telling you, with all the pain, even God forbid it was hundreds of dead or even thousands of dead, the job must get done once for all. You stop in the middle, you did nothing. That basically, it's like taking those soldiers and throw them to the garbage without achieving anything. If we already sacrificed such a sacrifice, at least we would know that after that we can sleep well at night. Of course, this is everything I say is, we're not talking about now what Hashem is doing to us because of the way we behave. That's a whole separate lecture now. We're talking about our ishtadlut. We have an army, we do ishtadlut, we try to fight our enemies. It's not the first time. We had thousands of wars in the last 3,000 years. So war, it's a matter of, it's a part of our life. It's an integral part of our life. Even though it said to Esav, al charbecha tichye, it seems to me that it was meant to us. Esav was a blessing that he got, is you're going to live by your sword.
So what is your solution?
There's only two things that can be done. One is that we have to fight cleverly without being afraid, without worry what the world has to say, without worry about the demonstration in France and in other places. That shouldn't be our concern. They can do whatever they want. That's the problem of the French government. They have cancer in their country just as bad as the Hamas in Israel. They're not going to wake up now and get rid of them. They're going to face what we face in a few years over there. They're going to shoot rockets in France also. Because remember how they are. They all learn from each other. If they see the Jews cannot handle the pressure, the Israeli army, the great Israeli army, they can do it all over the world.
Like you said, cancer.
Cancer.
The only way to do it, like you said, what?
100.
To kill all Palestinians and to get them out of there forever.
I have to tell you something. In a war, there is one rule. The first rule in a war, when you fight for your life, you have to make sure that you will survive and will not die, whatever the consequences are. If you can do it without killing one enemy, let it be. You get them out of the country, you occupy the area. If it would be an option like this, we would rather not to kill anyone. We're not into this business to kill anyone.
No, this is not that.
But if it's not the case like that, then we try to kill the ones who are shooting at us. If
they're
we can
all shooting, Rebbe, they all shooting. They grew up since 3 years old. They grew up hating the Jews. And you have to kill all of them.
Well,
if you want to kill them.
If you want to kill all the enemies of the Jews, you have to get ready to kill 4 billion people. Do you have the money and the time for it?
I'm happy you gave the answer.
Yeah, okay. So what do you expect? We have to do, you know, in medicine, there could be many sicknesses in a body. The doctors are focusing on the immediate life risk. Let's first save the patients not to die. Our threat right now is them, those few, I don't know, 10, 20, 30,000 murderers who we brought from Tunisia and gave them weapon and invited them into Israel with Arafat and his friends, and they built to us an army with the money of Iran. We are very foolish. Now we're paying the price. That's one problem. The second problem is, and that's the main problem. Until now, we spoke about efforts, ishtadlut. What is the main problem? The main problem is if the Israeli people planning to continue to walk naked on the street all summer and to make scenes and to violate Shabbat and to smash the yeshivot and fight against the Torah and curse the rabbis and try to cancel Brit Milah, I already tell them right now it will be recorded, it will be in a website. And the next round, they can just rewind and see what I say now. The same thing I say what 2-3 years ago, it's happening right now. I hope it won't be another round. But on the next round, maybe that will remind them. What brings all these problems is the way the children of Hashem behave. When your son behaves good, you give him a candy or an ice cream. When he does not behave good, you start by taking away his bike, and then you put him in a room, and then if that doesn't help, you give him a smack. And if that doesn't help, I don't want to say the rest what you do with him. But the point here right now is HaKadosh Baruch Hu sent us enough messages. People don't want to learn. What they say in Israel, what doesn't come through the head, comes through the legs. You don't want to learn the easy way. Continue with your sins. Every round will be worse than the one before. You have to understand now one thing. If this war wouldn't start now, maybe in 3, 4, 5 years, if we'll be relatively quiet, there will be the end of us. Because you have to understand, they were busy for the last 10 years to build a country under Israel with holes that they can come into Israel without passport, without borders, with no limitation. If they decide, if the Arabs decide to start a war with Israel 5 years from now, and they have tunnels who go all the way from Gaza, all the way to the Golan Heights, to Syria, all the way to the ocean, all the way to around the Egyptian border. They have tunnels everywhere that they can come out in any location in Israel as they want, with machine guns, with anti-tank missiles, with anti-helicopter missiles, with chemical weapon. All they have to do is to decide the date, like they did to us on Yom Kippur, and Syria attacks from the north with Hezbollah, Jordan from the Jordan side, and they come from the south, they come in Israel, the Israeli Arabs, which is about 2 million Israeli Arabs that are just as bad, most of them. So what would you do? You're gonna have, right now we cannot handle them. They're not in Israel right now, and we're basically not winning. We're not winning. We threw massive amount of explosive, and they still shoot rockets nonstop. Cannot stop it. Who's to promise that by the end of this war, with the horrible casualties that we have, they will stop shooting rockets? Maybe a week after they start again. What are you going to do, start another war? So I'm just telling you, if this war wouldn't start, 5 years from now will be 100 times worse. Because right now they're finding all these tunnels, they're going crazy. They say, where was our intelligence? How the Israeli Mossad and the Shabak and all the spies and all the Arab agents, remember, they have spies inside there. How we did not know that they have tunnels that goes to every part of Israel? Yeah, we make a wall and a fence and they come from under the ground. Beautiful for the wall. Remember last week, now we're going into our topic tonight. Tonight we're going to speak about the common question series. We continue our series. But if you remember, in the last week, we are not here. It was 17 of Tammuz. But if you remember 2 weeks ago, we asked if it was good to build a wall around Israel. Remember, that was one of the questions. So what's wrong with building a wall if you know now terrorists cannot walk into Israel because it's blocked? So they have a very difficult time to go and kill people. So the wall, security-wise, already proved itself that since they made the wall, there are much less attacks by coming and killing people or kidnapping people than they used to have before. Even though now they have tunnels, but it's not as convenient for them to come through the tunnel as if they just come directly with a car into Israel, finding some Jews, shooting at them, and returning right back. It's not as easy. But the only problem is that where they made the wall, that's not the border of Israel according to the Torah. Israel is more than double than that. So by making a wall around a certain territory in Israel, that's contradicting Hashem's will. If Hashem wants Eretz Israel to be from here to here, and we compromise and we surrounded our territories, half of what Hashem said. So that's by like us admitting for something that is not correct. Like we're saying, Israel, it's only this. But it's not true. Israel goes all the way to Syria, all the way to Iraq. If you look in until they are Prat and Nechidekel. When Mashiach comes, Yerushalayim will be all the way from Jerusalem to Syria, to Damascus. That will be the size of Jerusalem. Why? All the people in the world would want to live in Yerushalayim. So they will build more and more and more. It will expand and expand. It's called Eretz Vi, the land of the deer. Why the deer? Like they have deer park. In America, there's many places called deer park. Deer park means where the deers live. That's where they live, so they call it deer park. But what the Torah say deer, it doesn't mean where the deers live. The Torah speaks about the skin of the deer. What's special about the skin of the deer? This skin is different than other animals. You can stretch it and stretch it and stretch it. It's very elastic. You can stretch it if it's 2 feet. You can continue to stretch it. You heat it up. You stretch it more and more and more. It can become 10 feet. It doesn't get ripped easily. Other skin, the more you stretch, after a few stretches, it ripped in the middle. But so what the Torah is trying to say, that Jerusalem, it's like the skin of the deer. You can stretch it and stretch it, and it grows and it grows and becomes holier and holier. The neighbors that are attached to her. And this is the message here. So we'll continue with our series right now. Now, since we are in a war, maybe some of the questions that applies for war and for the army that we should start with. The question that a soldier asked, he said, I'm called for reserve. They call me for reserve. And they're giving me a job that is actually against the Torah. What is the job? I have to kick the Jewish people that live in certain territories. This question was given in a Gush Katif when a few years ago when we gave it to these murderers that you see today the results of it, that they had to take out all the Jews from their home and their synagogues, kick them out of the Jewish land and give it to these Hamas murderers. This is all Gush Katif area. So this soldier is a religious guy. He was called for reserve to go and evacuate the Jewish people by force. That's one of the biggest tragedies, in my opinion, since Israel became a country. So he asked if he should make lies, seek surgery, go to his friend, the doctor, to give him a false letter, any kind of way, if he can say that he's unable to come to the army in this time. Because he doesn't want to participate in such a crime against the Jewish people. Just because the government then made an agreement with America, Ariel Sharon, that he would give back all the land to this Hamas, thinking they're going to agree to stop shooting at us. I don't understand where this stupidity comes from. Every Jew in the land knows that there's nothing even to talk about. They won't stop until they destroy us all. There's nothing in the history would make them stop. Get it out of your system already. All these liberal Jews, it's about time to bang your head to the wall 500 times, 500,000 times. Get the dirt out of there. Get the stupidity out of there. Even a million times, until you finally understand the nation of Ishmael, it's not even in their hands. They will never rest until they kill all Jews. It's nothing to do with the land of Israel. Israel is not holy for them. Jerusalem is not mentioned in the Quran. They have in the Quran a part that say that they also believe that there's going to be redemption in the world. The Quran brainwashed them to believe that the redemption will never take place until they finish to kill all Jews. Even a Jew that hides behind the tree, that's how that says over there, it's for them a mitzvah to find him and slaughter him. Even without that, when you see how they behave to their own brothers and how they slaughter each other, and they hate us a lot more than they hate each other, make no mistake. What would happen if, God forbid, will be in their hand? Not one baby they would leave. They don't have mercy on babies. On things. They'll slaughter them with their hands. Not with accidental bombing, trying to defend themselves. They will go after them. They'll slaughter them one after the other. So the point is, all these people who think you can reach peace with them, you're wrong. There's never going to be a peace. Even if some of them would give up already, give up their belief, give up their mission in life to destroy the Jews, there will always be 20, 30, or 40% of them that will never rest. And that's already hundreds of millions of people. They'll never leave you alone. You finish with 1 million, you made an agreement with them, you have another 200 million waiting. What are you going to do? How are you going to divide Israel to 1.8 billion Muslims? How? When half of them, from morning to night, have only one thing in their mind, how they destroy the Jews, and how they destroyed all the Christians also. In Iraq, they just burned a church that is 1,800 years old. They don't even care that it's history, nothing. 1,800 years old. You know, it's one of probably the first churches in the world. How old is Christianity, Bichlal? It's less than 2,000 years old. So this is one of the first churches, or perhaps the oldest one in the world, maybe. Or one of the oldest ones. They just destroyed it. They went and destroyed all the churches now in Iraq. And even that one, they destroyed it. That's just for those who have hopes that if, God forbid, we'll be under their control, that they will leave our yeshivot or our synagogue or anything else. The answer is, keep dreaming. It will never happen. So the Torah told us, someone who has a plan to kill you, make sure to kill him before he touch you. Okay, so now he asks, is he allowed to make a trick to get away from the invitation to go to reserve? The answer, if you have to actually evacuate Jews with your own hands from their own homes, you have to do everything you can to get rid of this reserve service. Even if you have to go out of the country or to go into a hospital to lay down there and claim that you have fever and headache or whatever the case may be, no matter how difficult you have to work to get rid of this job, you have to do it. You should not agree to take people from their homes and destroy them mentally, physically, kick them out of their home. Something like this, there's no forgiveness. If you know after the Gush Katif tragedy that they gave it back to the Hamas murderers, Rav Ovadia Yosef Zatzal had in one of his lectures, he said about Ariel Sharon, that the one who initiated this whole thing, this agreement, which all his life was a very, very strong right-wing leader, all of a sudden became more left than left. So he actually was so angry at him that he said these words, he will sleep and will not wake up. He didn't say he should die. He said he will sleep and will not wake up. And he slept for eight years, and he only woke up 2 weeks after Rav Ovadia Yosef passed away. You see, from Shamayim, they didn't let him die. He was in coma for 8 years. Only when Rav Ovadia passed away and went up to the court of heaven, perhaps when they got to the moment what to do with him, whatever Rav Ovadia say over there, that's basically put an end to his suffering. 8 years to lay in a bed, cannot move. Even if he would open up his eyes, he wouldn't be able to move one muscle. Wouldn't be able to pick up his hand, wouldn't be able to move his arm, nothing. It's like paralyzed. It will take long, long time to bring him back into shape, and in this age, perhaps never. Just to show you the word of a tzaddik, of a big chacham. Now, I am serving in Golani. Golani is one of the highest level troops in a war. They just said 13 of them died in one missile yesterday. They're very brave, and they do a tremendous service to the nation, risk their life, not only in a time of war, in between wars also. And it's very, very difficult. And this soldier, he say, I'm in Golani, and there is something that called Golani, and there's something called Sayeret Golani. Sayeret means it's even higher, the highest, that they go from place to place, like a real unit, special unit. He said, I am in a regular Golani, but my ego is pushing me to go to Sayeret Golani. I know it's my ego, but it doesn't leave me alone. So what should I do? Should I go because I'm going not for the reason of protecting Israel or the Jews, just that I can show off when I come and everyone know I'm in Sayeret Golani, it's like I'm a, you know, top warrior. Should I go? Even though indirectly I'm gonna serve the nation, but I'm doing it for my ego, or because it comes from my ego, I should just stay in Golani, which is just as good. What do you think? From the Torah point of view. The answer is, every transaction a Jew does, which is a combination of two things, he does it for the sake of himself and for the sake of heaven at the same time. What do we do in a case like this? 50-50. 50% for Hashem and for protecting the Jewish nation, which is a big mitzvah, but 50% for his reputation and ego. And he can walk on the streets and everyone sees uniform and they know, ooh, top warrior commando. In a case like this, the pride overcome the for the sake of heaven, or for the sake of heaven overcome the pride? What do you think? The answer is, we have a rule. When a person begin not for the sake of heaven, it's just a matter of time until it turns into for the sake of heaven. So if it's 50-50 now, add this guarantee that eventually it will become more for the sake of heaven, so that will become a majority. Therefore, he's allowed to go. A soldier that was captured by the cruel Arabs and is in their prison, and he's afraid they're going to start torturing him to get information out of him. Is he allowed to kill himself in prison or no? To commit suicide or no?
Depending on what kind of information.
Huh?
Depending on what kind of information. Yeah. On all Jews or just...
Yes.
Let's say he doesn't know any information. Let's say he doesn't know information, but they will torture him one way or the other.
He's not allowed. He's still killing him anyway.
What's not allowed? Not allowed to give information or not allowed to kill himself?
Not allowed to kill himself.
We have Talmid Chacham over there. You have to think before you talk. The answer is, there is some exception to the rule. Even though it's a horrible, horrible sin to commit suicide, it's such a sin that a person who does it cannot be buried with regular Jews in the same cemetery. They have to make a wall between him and them. And also, they cannot even say Kaddish for him. because they won't even help him. Unless if they prove that he was in a depression and he wasn't responsible for his action or things like that. But the point right now, when a soldier is captured by the cruel Arabs, which they are just as cruel as the Nazis, no different. The things that they do to the prisoner, we cannot describe in words here. The question is, now he knows what they're going to do to him in an hour until they're gonna come and torture him. They torture him physically and they will also torture him mentally, which most likely, he will, if he ever come out of prison, he will have suffering for the rest of his life mentally. So should he just hang himself or take something and kill himself, and it won't count as a sin, or he should accept the suffering, whatever happened, happened. What do you think?
Doesn't the Gemara say that the more you suffer, the sword is on your neck, you still have hope?
But he's already, if he can't do mitzvot, he's like already dead.
I will tell you that the order of the Israeli IDF army is to the soldiers that even if there is a fear that they will get secrets out of you, we allow you not to kill yourself. Which means we will not hold you responsible because you got tortured and you gave up secrets. We're not going to take you to trial, no matter how big is the damage you caused, because we know it's a test that a person cannot pass. The torture that a person has is not realistic to overcome such test. So the army does not require the soldier to kill themselves. Other armies, by the way, they give them a pill that in case something like this happens, right away they swallow it and they kill themselves immediately. And if they won't, and if they come out of jail, they'll spend the rest of their life in Siberia or in some jail under the ground. Why? Why you didn't kill yourself? Now you're gonna pay for all the secrets you gave. But the Israeli army does not require to commit suicide. But we're not asking according to the laws of the Israeli army. We're asking according to the law of the Torah. Is it an exception to the rule that a person that is fear torture is allowed to kill himself or no? The answer is, the Gemara say that the Romans captured 400 boys and girls and took them on a boat to Rome. Rome, it's in Italy there. They took them to Rome, and the boys and the girls knew the only reason they're not leaving them in Israel, they're taking them to Rome, is for prostitution. They knew that. And they all jumped, they say, Shema Israel, they jumped to the water and committed suicide, and the Gemara speaks very highly of them. What do we learn from here? That there are cases in life, if a woman is afraid to have such an abuse, or male, or any kind of abuse and torture, they have permission to kill themselves. And they won't be held guilty in a court of heaven for this actual killing. If a person kills himself because he lost $10 million in a stock market, he's a murderer. If a person kills himself because his girlfriend left him, he's a murderer. If a person killed himself because he wanted to marry this girl and in the last minute she turned it down, she did not agree, it's called in Israel, Rabbi Ahava Nichzevet. Today one person, I don't know who he is, I never saw him. A few months ago he was dating a Goya, and he started to listen to my lecture, especially the intermarriage one. It made a big impact on him. So he contacted me then, and I encouraged him very much to break the relationship, and I said, Jews have no permission to marry any other nation. So he, back then, Baruch Hashem, it worked, and he broke it up with her. I think it was 6 months ago, 10 months ago. I already forgot about it completely. Today he sent me a letter. He said to me, thank you very much for ruining my life. I'm still depressed. I don't remember, 6 or 8 months after you told me to leave Christine. That was her name, Christine.
Finally got it.
Finally, I am this time perfect to the name. You know how many women in the world sending me emails, I am the Christine you are talking about in your lectures. It's a very common Christian name. If all the Christians who listen to the lecture would decide to unite and make a page in a Facebook, the victims of Rabbi Mizrahi lectures, have thousands of fans on the page. Anyway, so he told me and he wrote, thank you for making me break with my girlfriend, Christine. And he wrote in next to the thank you, in a parenthesis, sarcastic way. Don't think that I'm really thanking you. Like he's holding me responsible for saving his eternity. Understand? Why? It's called in Hebrew, Ahava Nichzevet. How do you say it in English? Huh? Not false. Bitter, heartbroken, I don't know. Some words you just don't have in English.
Even friends close, enemies close. Even friends close, enemies close, no?
Yeah. Next thing.
Rabbi, let me ask you a question.
Yeah.
So according to that, if he thinks he's going to be tortured, he's allowed to kill himself. Is that right?
He's not obligated, but he's allowed. Yeah.
But let's say you go according to what we saw in the past. So if we know previously they take one soldier and they say, we'll feed you 1,000 of our prisoners.
Right.
Of Palestinians, you don't really know what's going to happen.
Just for that, the soldier should hurry and kill himself right away. Why? Why? Because if he's really, really righteous, the soldier, and he care about the Jewish nation, and he care about Hashem's wish, he should do the right thing because he knows that once they redeem his life, they will release 1,000 murderers that will kill hundreds of Jews. Those are the ones who shoot rockets at us. Some of them we caught and put them back in prison for terrorist attack. Do you know that? As soon as we got them out of jail, the next day they're already in a Hamas killing Jews. Not maybe one day they'll go back to terrorism. We make them sign, I never go back to terrorist activities. The next, perhaps before he went to say hello to his mother, he already went to visit the Hamas. Do you have a job for me for tomorrow morning? Yeah, you see this truck? There's 20 missiles over there. You go to that hill, you shoot here, there. They already give him a job. From the jail directly to the work. So what kind of decision it was? What's better, to lose 100 or to lose one? So it wasn't such a genius decision. You know, I used to be a rabbi, very, very, very big one, 800 years ago. His name was Maharam Mirotenburg. That was a very, very big, just like Rashi's level in this kind of category. So the goyim put him in prison and they demanded tons of money to release him. So he made a rule. He said to his student, no one is allowed to pay a penny for me. I forbid that. I will rotten in their jail for the rest of my life, and no one will give the money to get me out of here. No one is allowed. Why? He knew if it will work, they would non-stop kidnap Jews for more and more money. So he said, I'd rather suffer all my life that other Jews will not fall into the same situation because of me going to freedom. That's a tzaddik. If I have to suffer, I'm in your hand. You want to release me, you release me. You don't want to release me, I'll die here. But guess what? They did not let go of this goyim. When he died in prison, they refused to release his body. Until after a while, one of his students paid money, and he released his body. And they said that after that, something like this happened, that the end of that student was that his grave was right next to him, next to this rabbi, mamash in the same place. Mishamayim, they arranged that his grave would fall right next to him. I don't remember all the details of the story, but you got the idea here. That was a very big thing to do. One of the soldiers that failed or that died today, 7 soldiers died in one attack. One body, pieces of the body, they picked up, the Hamas, and stole it. expect now the release of hundreds of terrorists for few pieces of his body. They want little hand, little thing, piece of here. They're going to collect everything in a box. You want this box? Release 300, 400, 500 murderers. It's not the first time it happened. For three bodies, we gave them hundreds of prisoners. For bodies, of dead bodies. Now, next thing. I'm in the army, and I have to sleep with my shoes on because of the danger. If the siren or attack, you have to get up and begin to run. No time to put the army shoes. It's very hard to get it in. But it also say that someone who sleeps with the shoes, it's like tasting from the taste of death, which means it's not such a good thing. So what do I do? Do I take the shoes anyway, even though I'm supposed to, like all the soldiers instructed to sleep with the shoes? Or I have to sleep with the shoes? What do you think? The answer is, that's a beautiful answer. Better just the taste of the dead than the actual death. I am a chatan first year, which according to the Torah, someone who just got married is dismissed from going to the army for the first year after his marriage. He has to be with his wife and make her happy. In today's generation, after 3 weeks, the wife say, Moshe, go to the army. go, the nation needs you. After he leaves, she comes, and as soon as he gets on a train, Baruch Sheptarani Me'on Shoshel Ze. Anyway, it doesn't make her happy. What does she need him? But then, one thing. When he gets on the train, she screams, Moshe, did you leave me the credit card? If not, she ran after the train all the way to Lebanon. So the question is, now, in a war like today, somebody who just got married 6 months ago, 1 month ago, 10 months ago, and they call him for miluim. Miluim means reserve. Is it a violation of the Torah or not?
It's a mechavas mitzvah.
Very good, very good. There are two kinds of wars. There's wars that the Torah say, the Torah call it milchemet mitzvah, war of a mitzvah. When your life is in a risk, you have to protect the people from dying, automatically it becomes milchemet mitzvah. Some milchamot, it's reshut in the Torah. Kadosh Baruch Hu says, if you want, you can go and fight, but some of them, it's an obligation. Once it's an obligation to go to a war, like this war now, it's for sure milchemet mitzvah, no one is dismissed, even someone who got married yesterday. From Yisheva Brachot, he hears the sirens, toot, 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 his phone, toot, 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 yeah, come to this intersection, in 1 hour the bus is waiting. From his Sheva Brachot, with his suit. He writes right away. He runs, and he goes to Gaza to fight. I am an officer in the Israeli army who is in the commando, which means life risk around the clock. After my wedding, my new wife asked me to move into a base in Israel, not to be in a dangerous area. And I did. Now the war started, and it kills me that all my soldiers are risking their life while I'm sitting here in an office. I'm dying to join them, to protect the nation. What should I do? Should I listen to my wife and stay in the office inside Israel? or I should go and fight to save the Jewish nation and join my soldiers of my unit. What should I do? The answer is, Aseh keretzon ishtecha. Listen to your wife. Cannot do mitzvah ba ba'avera. You have an obligation. You signed that you'll be a husband, not an astronaut. A person came to his wife. He said, Hare at mekudeshet li, with one condition. What? That I fly to the moon and see you in Olam Haba. So what do you think her answer is? She said, give me 1 hour to answer your question. She went and checked something, and then she said, I agree. No, what did she check? How much money he has in his bank account? Stay in the moon. I'll get the money. Not one person, one, you know, in teacher parents conference, so they call one of the father, so he comes, he meets the Rebbe, and the Rebbe say to him, Mr. Leibowitz, your son is always flying in space. He's not in class, he's not listening to anything I say. When I approach him, he wakes up from his dreams. I don't know what to do with him anymore. So the father say, ishtabach shemo, my son always had a dream to be an astronaut. Now, I want to join the commando of the Israeli army, because I'm becoming a soldier now, but I'm afraid. I'm afraid from this horrible war. Should I force myself to do it, even though I'm very afraid? Because some of my friends, they're not afraid. They're proud to go. They're looking for action. We'll give our life over, no problem. But I'm afraid. I know it's going to be, for me, a disaster. Not such a brave guy. Should I force myself to go? Or because I'm a chicken, I stay with the roosters in my neighborhood?
Huh?
In a war, it says someone that is afraid should not go to the war. Mi ha'ish ha'arach v'ha'yareh levav. Someone that his heart is soft and is afraid should turn around now and don't go. Why? Because if in the middle of the combat he will turn around and begin to run, everyone would run after him because it makes them psychologically weak. But make no mistake, doesn't apply to today. Why? The reason that they say that in the time of the Torah, because every soldier knew that if he made one sin in the way that Hashem ran the world 3,300 years ago, most likely you don't come back from the war. Not like today when 70-80% of the soldiers don't even keep Shabbat. We are now talking people who keep all the laws, but they knew that they spoke between putting the tefillin on the hand and putting the tefillin on the head. They say a word to somebody. After they made the bracha, you're not allowed to talk. You have to put the tefillin off the head. But he knew that he spoke. Already it was enough danger not to return back from the war. That's how strict the law was. In one hand, you see clear miracles on the open. On the other hand, every sin could be already enough not to come back from the war. So someone who knew he made a hidden sin and they're about to get the soldiers to go to the war, he knew he's not going to come back. Because of his sin, mentally he cannot focus, you know, I'm about to die now. So they say someone who is afraid, they give him a way out. Someone who is afraid, better not to go. But today, unfortunately, when we are full of sins, we can't even count how many sins each one of us has. If we fill up 500 semi-trailers with our sins, it wouldn't be even 1%. Why? Lashon Hara, violation of Shabbat, modesty, internet, kosher food, all kinds of other problems. In a case like that, one sin more, one sin less gonna make you die in a war. If you have clean sheet and you have one serious sin, then you're afraid. But if you already, that's everyone, that's the whole army like this.
Nowadays you have missiles, you have machine guns, it's not like before, swords, and you can shoot arrows. Now people, they already shake and they hear a grenade. All the more so they see all kinds of crazy things going on. They see bloodshed, what are they gonna do?
No, but let me explain to you something. If Hashem would apply the same concept of 3,300 years ago today, as soon as the soldiers who go cross the line of the border between Israel to Gaza, unfortunately, not one of them would survive. Based on this concept, that person that have sins does not come back from the war. Do you know today a soldier that is clean from sins? Show me one. People inside the best yeshivot in the world, they're full of sins. So it's needless to say 80% of the army is complete secular. Not only sins, it's Yisurei Karet every minute. The world sins. Most of them don't even know they're making sins. Maybe they're not even guilty. They don't even know what's sin, what's not a sin. Baruch Hashem, Hashem goes with lots of mercy and understanding in this generation. If he would judge us strictly as it used to be, in a time when we used to go to the war, in the time of Moshe Rabbeinu, and right after, or David HaMelech, who would survive? You know anyone would survive? Not one person would survive in a war.
Why? Yeah. Because you're going into a dangerous place?
Huh?
Because you're going into a dangerous place?
Because you're going into a war. War is a place where, unfortunately, people are...
It's a dangerous place, of course.
Huh?
Why didn't they do teshuvah before? I said, it'll be forgiven. How could you die to go into war? What did they do with it?
First of all, I have to assume that a soldier, before he goes to a war, even a secular one, does some kind of a teshuvah. Or at least they pray to Hashem, please help me, save me. Secular people pray to Hashem from time to time, in a time of problem mainly, or when they want their team to win the championship. Yes.
Now with what's going on, that there are certain healing that they suggest that people should say, like relevant to the war, like that David HaMelech, when he was in war, I think one of them was like 144, and David speaks about how he, you know, is asking Hashem to save me and was scared. But my question, I always have this question, he had the prophecy from Shmuel that he was going to become king. So didn't that, like, give him the confidence already that nothing was going to happen to him? Like, wasn't...
All the righteous people in the history, even Yaakov Avinu, David HaMelech, Moshe Rabbeinu, many others, even if they had clear promise from Hashem that he will protect them and take care of them and the future is beautiful, they still lived with a constant fear that maybe now they just did something wrong and they lost the promise of Hashem. Shema Yigrom Achet. Remember this concept. There is always a gun on the head. Shema Yigrom Achet. Like a father said to his son, son, I'm very happy from you. From all my sons, you're the only one who I really appreciate very much. So when I die, I would leave you all the business for you, as appreciation for you helping. But the son always live with the fear, maybe one day he'll do something that the father will get so upset that he'll change his mind based on what he did tomorrow. Now, the son sometimes does things and he's thinking to himself, I wonder what my father thinks about what I just did. Is it enough for him to take back his promise or not? That's why they live with the fear. The more righteous you are, the more you're fearing the sins that you do. Only ignorant and only fools and only wicked people sleep well at night. Shalom aleich nafshi. They don't worry about anything. Ani tzaddik. Ani, I'm rabbi, ani tzaddik. I don't do anything bad to anyone. You don't do anything to anyone. Yeah.
What about Emunah? You're always the
rabbi. Emunah, what's the contradiction?
You said a person is Emunah, he goes to sleep without any worries.
No, Emunah, it's about something else. Emunah does no guarantee I live tomorrow. What's the Emunah has to do with living or not? Emunah is about parnasa, about health, or whatever bad happened to me, it's for the good. That's Emunah. Emunah doesn't mean that bad things won't happen. Emunah doesn't mean that I have a guarantee to have a job or a guarantee that my pockets would always be full. Emunah, it's no guarantee I'll have children. Emunah, there's no guarantee I'll find a shidduch. Emunah means Hashem runs the world. I have to do my part, and the rest is for sure good. Nothing else. That's Emunah. Everything else is people making up. There's no Emunah. I'm Mechalel Shabbat, and I'm going to live for sure to 100 years old. He can have Emunah as much as he wants. If Hashem doesn't want him, I'll take him tomorrow morning out of this world with all his Emunah. Sometimes you have to know one thing. Sometimes it's hard to tell the difference between emunah and stupidity. Yes, some people are stupid. And they think that they are great believers. They're just not thinking, or not thinking right. So we have to be very careful. That's why a person wants to do something tremendous, he must ask a Talmid Chacham first if to do it or not. I told you, I don't know if you are not here, a year or two ago, I said that there's a student, medical student. I didn't know him. I mean, I knew him from time to time. He was donating money, $100, $150 for CDs. And, you know, I always, everyone who donates, I write him a special thank you, blessing, whatever. So he always answered, thank you, it's my pleasure, I have to thank you. You know, we go back and forth a few emails. One time he comes to me and he said to me, I want to donate all my life saving to your CDs. So I said to him, is it allowed? He asked. I said, it's not allowed. You can give 10%, and if you're very wealthy, you can give 20%. So I wrote in the email, unless if you come from a very rich family, what do I know? Maybe his father is a billionaire. What is it for him? He's a student. Maybe he has some money on the side. His future is secure. I wrote, unless if you come from a very wealthy family, you don't have to worry about money. That's a different story. But if you're an ordinary person, so he wrote to me, I'm a student for medical in St. Louis over there. He originally is from California. And he had about $36,000 life saving. And he said, no, it's not, my father is not super rich or anything like that. He was willing to give all his money. Now, if he wouldn't talk to me, if he wouldn't ask me before, he would already make the donation, whatever the case is. He gave it up, whatever. That wasn't the clever thing to do. Nowhere in the Torah it says you have to take all your savings and give it to donation, no matter how important the cause is. The more you give, the better it is, for sure. But you also have to leave some money for tomorrow morning to have what to eat. If you're in a level of Moshe Rabbeinu, you don't have to worry. You know the man will come tomorrow to your door. But how many like this we have in a generation? But you know what? One good thing came out of that story. When I told that story in one of my lectures, the next day I got an email from a woman from New York. She said, I heard about the story about that medical student that was willing to give all his money to save Jewish souls. I was so impressed. It made me think about my daughter. She's also a student for medical, and she's always exactly like that. When she sees that something is a big mitzvah, she would now have no hesitation, take everything she has and give it out. Maybe, what do you think? Maybe we should make a shidduch between them. I made the shidduch, and Baruch Hashem, it worked out. So you see, Hashem gave him the reward, even though he never ended up doing what he wanted to do. But he got the rotze lasot mitzvah, someone who wanted to do mitzvah and was forced not to. If Hashem see he really did it for the sake of heaven with all his heart, he gives him the reward like he actually did it. Baruch Hashem. Now, I'm in the army, and today it was the first time I shot a gun. Can I? I'm very happy about it and very proud of myself that I shot very well. Can I make Berachat Shehechiyanu? What do you think? What do you think? No? Ah, Rabbi, what do you think? Becoming a good soldier, is that a mitzvah? It's mitzvah, no? The Jewish nation always had soldiers. David HaMelech, Shlomo HaMelech, Yehoshua, Moshe, everyone had an army. Yes. A little bit louder. Yeah. Why? It's not tzar to kill the enemies of God and the enemies of the Jewish nation. It's very big happiness. Be'avod reshaim rina, David HaMelech said. When you see a Hamas terrorist, his head explode to millions of pieces, you open up champagne and make shecheyanu. Yes. It's not, and don't be a hypocrite and start pretend. Abba, it's not humanic. The liberal Jews are crying at home that there's some murderer of children getting killed. I don't want anything to do with these people. One woman commented on my Facebook page. She said, I spoke about an Arab woman who sits in Israeli Knesset, and she was on the boat that came from Turkey that killed Israeli soldiers. If you remember, attacked Israeli soldiers. The Israeli retaliated and killed 8 Muslim, Turkish, or whatever, peace activists. And she was on a boat. She's working for Israel. She received money from the Israeli government, and she betrayed the Jewish nation, the Israeli nation. You have an Israeli passport. You have to be an Israeli citizen. You cannot go against the government, against the army, against the police. What's going on here? Just because you're a politician, you're allowed to do whatever you want? So someone sent me a very nice thing. So I put it on my Facebook page. It broke the record of all Facebook, of all time, of all the millions of pages. When it comes to Jewish pages, I mean. Not the Goyish, there's nothing you can compete with. And close to 1 million views this article had in one day. More than 1 million, almost close to 1 million. Maybe by tomorrow morning we'll go over 1 million. 43,000 likes it had. And she commented, she said, you encouraging hatred to who? To a woman who said on the news that to the Hamas, you're not doing a good job. You have to aim better to kill the Israelis. I want her to be my sister, this Arab terrorist. If it was up to me, I would hang her with my own hands. Why? If not, I'm a Rasha. Someone that has an enemy of Hashem, someone who encouraged murders of Jewish children, and he has mercy on them, he is a very big Rasha. Don't make mistakes here. Someone that has mercy on murderers that kill children and women, you have mercy on him, you are a very, very wicked person. Don't think that you're humanic, you're liberal, human rights. There is no human rights to people that behave worse than animals. There are animal rights. The animals are not guilty. They deserve rights. People that behave like animals, they don't deserve any rights. Do you understand what I'm saying here? Not my opinion. Don't think I made it up. It's nothing to do with politics. This is what the Torah say. This is what the Talmud say. Kol amerachem al achzarim, sofo litachzer larachmanim. Someone who has mercy on the cruel will end up being cruel for the merciful one. Guarantee. That's why when Jews die, they don't care. They demonstrate in Tel Aviv when a murderer died. Why you don't demonstrate that Israelis died? They don't even care. Nothing. They only care when a murderer and a Palestinian murderer died. It kills them. No, what else? I have to be worried about them? I have to worry about my brothers and my sisters. With them, I want unity. I don't want unity with someone who stands with a big flyer in the middle of the street and call the soldiers who give their life to protect our children, they call them murderers when they act in a self-defense. I don't want someone that called the policeman a murderer when he chased a murderer to catch him. I don't want this kind of brothers and sisters. Neither you are. If you're normal, you don't want anything to do with them. It's called in Hebrew Yefei Nefesh. We are tired of this kind of left liberal that cause cancer to our nation. You gotta stay away from them, not to get involved with them, not to do anything with this kind of people, not to marry them, not to do business with them, and definitely not to feel sorry for them. You understand why? Because they are the real enemies before the Arabs. The Arabs know nothing besides killing us. It seems that that's their job in the creation. But someone who called himself Cohen or Levy or Rosenberg or whatever his name is, he's standing with the flags and he is happy that 30 soldiers died. Literally, they're happy. Not only that, if they could, they would sell the secrets of Israel to the Hezbollah and to the Hamas to help them to kill us. Some of them were on the boat fighting the Israelis. Israeli citizen on the boat that come to attack this Israel. You understand what's happening here? Anyone here disagree with what I say, raise his hand. Don't be afraid. Let's talk about it peacefully. Yes.
Neturei Karta,
HaKadosh Baruch Hu, in this, as we speak right now, create a special Gehenom for them. The Gehenom that he has, the hell that HaKadosh Baruch Hu had for now, it's not enough for them. They are the worst monster that the Jewish nation had from the time the world was created until now. No one is worse. No one is worse than the Neturei Karta. They are the biggest criminals in history. Neturei Karta, all of them, with no exception. All of them who stands with signs and they cry and they put Palestinian flags. And they are happy that Israelis are dying, and they put Palestinian flags in Mea Shearim in their windows, and they demonstrate in the whole world, and they call the Israelis criminal for sitting in the Holy Land. You see, let me explain to you something. There is the Satmar movement. Satmar, they're not happy from the Zionist nation, from the Zionist country. They're against the Israeli government. They're against the education in the schools in Israel. They're against the Israeli army. They're against many, many things that some other Jews are pro those things. But they will not stand on Fifth Avenue in front of the CNN reporter and put Palestinian flag on their head and cheer for the murderers of our children. You understand? Someone that does that, he makes the entire Jewish nation suffer all over the world. You have to know what happened in a synagogue in France. It's their fault. When they stand and the whole world see them, what they do in Manhattan and in other places, demonstrate for the murderers, why the goyim shouldn't do the same? If they see Hasidic Jews, they don't understand the difference. You understand? So this is what I said. For them, the regular hell is not enough. HaKadosh Baruch Hu have to make a special section for them. You understand? Why? The regular punishments is not enough for these monster criminals. That's what it is. Yes?
Just a quick question, because the Torah says that you're not allowed to rejoice when your enemy falls.
Yes.
I want to understand the
difference. Not enemy that comes to kill you. Okay. With them, you rejoice. Vod ech you rejoice. You understand? Sure, you rejoice. Of course, when Goliath died, everyone made a party. They're very happy. Why not? What's better, to fall in his hands?
And the second point, Havodah Hargah Hashkin Lahargo.
Yeah.
So the only solution will be is to flatline every single one of them. It's not, I mean, you worry about the world, what they're going to say. But
yeah.
Besides making sure, which Hashem will help us, what is the...
You don't have to. You don't really have to kill all of them. All you have to do is to shut the electric and the water there. And slowly, slowly, make the army take another inch and another inch and another inch, and they all run to Jordan, to Egypt, to Tunisia, to Libya, to Sudan. They'll run because there's no electric, no nothing. You don't give them. That's it. They leave the place. You don't need to kill anyone.
Tunnel. What are you talking about? They're making tunnels. They make their own electricity. They got money. They got missiles.
They make tunnels with the electricity that we give them. And by the way, we also pay the bills for them. Do you know what the bill? There's an outstanding balance now, more than $12 million that they did not pay the Israeli electric company.
It's not a big amount for them, trust me.
No, you don't get it. They're not paying the electric bill, this chatzufim. They use the electric to murder us, and we don't shut their electric. Why? Why? We're afraid what Obama would say.
No electricity will solve.
Did you ever live without electric? I lived 1 week without electric. You know what it is? In this humidity, you sweat all day. You don't have hot water. You don't have light. You come to the house with candles. Remember the blackout? That was 1 week. Trees fell. 1 week there was no electric in our block. You don't have your telephone. You cannot charge your telephone.
They bring the batteries. They bring the diesel.
How long? How long you can live like that? 1 month, 2 months, 3 months. That's it. You give up. You run away. People today cannot live without electric.
I have a better solution. Instead of just doing this torture with electricity in the water, just put a chemical weapon, within 1 week they will be all disappearing completely.
Now I tell you what's the difference.
Let me explain to you something.
When Assad gases people, the world bark for a day or two, and right after that, like nothing happened. If you do it, that would be the end of us.
You're doing it with the water and electricity.
No. I don't have an obligation to sell you electric, especially when you don't pay the
Absolutely.
Bill.
Absolutely. We're going to just not sell you anything. We know when you don't have any other source. We just can't.
Wait, I don't understand. You compare gassing people to not selling them electric?
Nothing.
You really compare those two? What's wrong with you? Come on. I can see that 2 weeks you didn't come to the lecture.
Not 2 weeks. What?
Number 2 weeks. Last week you didn't come also.
Not also, that's the only time.
No, last week you didn't come, and the week before you didn't come.
No.
You're the only one that I know for sure when you come and when you don't come.
I was next to you in Miami, you didn't see me.
I want to tell you something. When you come, I hear it the next day with the amount of emails that I get. I have one Russian guy from Queens that came, drove 15 minutes to my lecture to speak to me after the lecture to get your telephone number and address if he can come speak to you in Russian. I don't want to tell you what was the subject. All right, let's move on. So it says like this. I took uniforms from the army and did not return when I quit after 3 years. I want to return it. I want to do tshuva. Do I have to just throw it in any place of the army and it eventually will go into the system, or I have an obligation to return it exactly to the same locker room where I got it? The army is one unit. So if I can give it, it's like a car rental. You rent it in New York, you give it in Miami. It's the same enterprise, whatever their name is. So it goes to the same company. So they even arrange it for you like this. The question is, over here, we're not renting. He stole something and he has to return it. Does he have an obligation to return it to the same exact base where he got it? Or he can return it to a different base, and eventually, maybe a year later, they're going to see they have extra or whatever, or they're just going to use it over there. I gave it back to the government. What difference does it make where exactly I gave it to? I gave it back. What do you think?
Depends if the unit where I got the uniform is responsible for the loss of this uniform. If that unit is responsible, have to return there. If there is no difference and just a moral move, then you can return it anywhere.
The answer is, it's logical what you say, but the answer is, anywhere in the army you give it back, it counts, you give it to the owner. Because the army owns it, that's it. It's like I have a friend that has 10 stores. If I stole from one of his store a jacket, and I ended up putting it in another one of his store, the money came back to his pocket, no? What difference does it make if it's here or there? Or I hang it over here instead of there. Do you really think he's going to ship it?
No, it's in the army. I don't know, it's something that they use up there.
Maybe because of that you fired the security from the other store, so you better come over there and just to say, yeah, listen, I took it from here.
My parents ask me if I go to Gaza, am I allowed to lie to them and say no, I stay in Israel for not making them worry?
No.
Oh, I must tell them the truth that yes, tomorrow I'm going there, which is hell on earth.
You're allowed. You're allowed.
You're allowed. You're allowed to lie for peace, but I don't know if this is the same.
Yes. What's the point of making him sit home and cry all day and be nervous and chas v'shalom get a heart attack or panic attack? What do you get by that? Better not to make anyone worry if you can. Even if you have something that chas v'shalom, the doctors say that maybe you have chas v'shalom cancer, maybe. And until you're gonna get the x-rays back, why to make people worry now for 2-3 weeks? You can say to people, pray for me, I don't feel good. Or I'm going into a special exam. But you don't want people to worry for nothing because people suffer. To worry means to suffer. Next thing, I'm in the army, and they gave me an assignment to do on Shabbat. Since the army is pikuach nefesh, we have to patrol, to protect the borders, to be on alert. Am I allowed to take food with me, like peanuts, wafers, things to carry with me to Nash while I'm serving? Or that's already not a necessary chilul Shabbat. Maybe I'm only allowed to take my rifles and my bandage, or things for the actual being a soldier or a keeper. But am I allowed to put peanuts or something or chocolate to entertain my time? Because remember, you carry it on Shabbat. You go from area to area. That's maybe not necessary to protect the land. The chocolate would make me a better soldier? What do you think?
Of course it's allowed.
If it's done to keep you more alert or not to make you fall asleep, one way not to fall asleep is to chew a gum. Even though it looks very bad, move his mouth like a cow. But sometimes when a person is very tired and he's learning and he falls asleep, so he puts a gum, he moves his mouth, it keeps him up. So he was learning an extra hour of Torah thanks to this alat gera.
So what about smoking cigarettes?
So that's already a killer. Smoking cigarette is killing yourself, not allowed.
If a soldier needs a cigarette on Shabbat, he has to smoke a cigarette, it's
a little crazy. No. The smoking cigarette makes him a better soldier? It will make him not fall asleep. It's actually make him more relaxed. You know, when a person is busy smoking, Muhammad is ready. That's called being a wise guy. Not you. A soldier that in the middle of protecting the land, he asks, okay, since I'm anyway violating Shabbat, I might as well smoke. Come on. Even the people who cannot fast on Tisha B'Av, let's say, or 17 of Tammuz, or any fast, because they have sugar, high sugar, diabetic. So what do you think? They're allowed to eat whatever they want? No. They're only allowed to eat little bread at the time and water, not Coke, not orange juice, not iced tea, none of these things. Only very little bread at the time, one or two bites every 2-3 hours, that the system, the sugar's level will be balanced. Not celebrating now Chinese. He goes to the restaurant, 5 sushi, this, Chinese. What? Tisha B'Av today. Hey, I have sugar.
What kosher place will open up Tisha B'Av?
Huh?
What kosher place will open up Tisha B'Av, first of all?
No, they open because they prepare for the evening.
Oh, okay.
You know, I one time remember my friend who used to own a restaurant, and there was one wicked person, mamash barbaric monster, that used to come on the 17th of Tammuz when my friend used to make orders for after the fast, or people, he prepare food for the night when people come. So he used to come in the middle of the day when everyone in town is fasting. He comes inside and say, ah, smell delicious, the food. Give me this, give me that. He said, we close. We only open at 8 o'clock tonight. He say, no. So my friend called me up. He say, what should I do with him? He's dangerous, this guy. I say to him, tell him I cannot serve you. So he's with me on the phone. He said to this monster, I'm sorry, I cannot serve you. So he said, okay, no problem. I'll serve myself. He went behind the counter, started to take seat and home, and of course he didn't pay when he left. Yeah. Monsters are, the world is full of them. Shh. I'm a woman. I want to be in a commando. Fighter. She watched too many movies in Hollywood when the women all of a sudden became Rambo. So she has an illusion, delusion, whatever you want to call it. So, allowed or not allowed? Not allowed. Women are not allowed in the army at all. Not even in commando, even in other jobs. Same reason why women not allowed in yeshivot. Everyone has a job in life. I had a woman that, Baruch Hashem, I met a religious, young girl, Baala Tshuva. And she said to me, you have to find me yeshiva, I want to learn Gemara all my life. She was so smart, this girl, Israeli girl, very clever girl. We see right away the regular lectures is not for her level. She wanted serious learning. She didn't leave me alone. I have to learn Gemara, I don't care. I said, no, women don't sit and learn Gemara, it's addictive. Once you get addicted to it, you don't care about your husband, you don't care about your children, you don't care about your obligations, nothing. You became a man, finished. Plus, women, when they're in the army, they can get caught and can get raped. Or they can put physical torture on them and they will easily give the secrets right away because they're afraid for their safety. Plus, mentally, they're not capable of doing certain things that the army requires. Plus, it's disrespect certain things to do to a Jewish girl, which is a daughter of HaKadosh Baruch Hu. Same thing, a Jewish girl cannot be a witness in a Jewish court. Why? Because she's a liar? Because she's not reliable? Because she's stupid? Why? The answer, none of the above. She's smarter than the man, she's most likely more reliable, and she will be a better witness than any average person. So why she's not allowed? Because when a woman comes to testify about a murder or about something that we're about to execute the defendant, they're gonna put pressure on her in the cross-examination. The lawyer from the other side will humiliate her, just like they humiliate the boy, the man. The problem is, a woman that is the symbol of dignity in Judaism, is the foundation of the Jewish nation, the mother of the holy kids, the symbol of modesty, Bat Melech, daughter of the king, she sits on a stand, and the lawyer goes into dirty stuff in their life and begin to show in front of the whole world and her children what a horrible person she is, and how she used to do this, and how she was in college. That's what they do. And then HaKadosh Baruch Hu does not agree that women would be in such a position. Why? This is the princesses of his nation. He doesn't want them there. Not because he doesn't trust them. If he didn't trust them, he wouldn't put the future of the Jewish children in their hands. He wouldn't do it. So don't believe all kinds of nonsense that people sell you. Everything has a logical reason. Before we finish, time is running out.
Why did you go now to Israel?
The girls, when they're little kids, it's no problem. Later, when they become older, then they have to clear time for their real obligation in life. Next thing. The army offered me two jobs, and I have to choose between them. And I don't know which one to choose. What's the criteria to know which one of the jobs to choose? Sometimes they're offering you to be a cook, to be a driver, to be a fighter, to be a secretary, to be an electrician, to be a mechanic. The army gives you, when a person joins the army, they say to him, this is what we need. We need electricians, we need this, we need that, we need that. Which one you like? This one will be in the north, this one will be in the south, this one will be close to Tel Aviv, this one will be every day you go home, this one every 2 weeks you go home. They give him an idea that we need soldier in all this category. Choose! What do they care? They need anywhere. First come, serve. He wants to know which job to take. How does a soldier choose where to go to the army?
Then you're going to be the best.
You started good.
The things that you know better?
No. How do you choose?
Whatever is more religious, more
fruitful. Whenever he's going to be able to practice religion without interference the most. Place that he will have time to pray, to learn more Torah, or if it's, for instance, they tell him you be a driver, you drive a chief commander, and you be his personal driver. Fantastic job. Why? He's going into his meetings, he's going into training, you sit in a car 3-4 hours waiting for him. You put the rabbi inside, you listen to CDs, all day lectures. On the other hand, they can give you a job, you don't have time to open Sidur Bechlal. אשר יושבתך, יתגדל ויתקדש, השם שפתי תפתח, עושה שלום, עלינו לשבח, יאללה, go back to the work. השם, a little bit of each. You know, there used to be a big חכם, רב יונתן אייפשיץ. His father saw that he told him to learn something, so he was learning the beginning and the end. Beginning and the end. So he saw in a davening, he told him to pray from here to here. So every chapter, he used to say the first verse and the last verse, and skip. 20 minutes, he finished the whole Tfilat Shabbat. So his father told him, tell me, you pray faster than me? Took me 2.5 hours, you finish in less than half an hour? So he told him, no, I did the beginning and the end of every chapter. Just like we do in the night of Shavuot or Hoshana Rabbah, we read a little bit from the beginning, a little bit from the end. It counts like we read the whole chapter. Because we just go, we review briefly. Don't have time in one night to learn the whole Chumash, whatever. So his father heard him. He said, okay, I heard you. On Shabbat, the father was serving fish. You know? So each one get a whole fish. This boy. So for him, he cut the eye of the fish with the mouth and the tail. And he gave him the eye and the tail, like this, two little pieces. You cannot eat it anyway, there's no meat there. So he said to him, what's this, Abba? He said to him, if you get the beginning and the end, it counts like you got the whole thing. And he got his message. A soldier that is not Jewish, like Russians that came to Israel, 80% of them goyim, they join now the army. And they risk their life to protect the land of Israel. Or Druzim, the Druze, yeah. Even though they speak Arabic, and you may not tell the difference between them and an average Palestinian when they speak Arabic, they can tell right away the difference. For us, Israel is not always easy. they already proved their reliability for 60, 70 years since Israel became a state. They help Israel, and they give their life, and many of them die for protection of the land, the Druze. This is unlikely. We never found, I don't think in the history the Jewish people had such an ally that were so honest and reliable like this Druzin. I don't think there was ever an incident with them that they betrayed the country. There's no liberal Druzim against Israel like there are traitors among the Jews. Remember, in Israel you have thousands of liberal lefty Jews who would do everything to help Hamas to kill Jews with no hesitation. But I don't think there is one like this among the Druzim, even though they're not Jewish. They gave many of their children to die to protect Israel. They hate the Hamas more than Israel hates them. It's very interesting. Some say they are the descendants of Yitro, Jethro. That's why it's a special blessed goyim, this Druzim. One time, I went to Fairlawn, New Jersey. Fairlawn, New Jersey, half an hour from Muncie. They told me somebody died, and the daughter of this person sitting Shiva. Do you want to come give a speech there in Hebrew? I said, where is it? Fairlawn. How many people? Every night more than 150 people come. It's a big house. Everyone comes. They pray there, everything, meals. You know how it is in a Shiva. As soon as I heard, I said, of course, let's make a night. Night before the Shiva was ended, we made a lecture. I went there, 150 secular Israelis, guys and girls, couples, the house is full of people. I started to give a lecture. What am I speaking about? The difference, because since everyone is secular, I have to encourage them to understand what does it mean to be a Jew. So I'm beginning to speak about the difference between Jews, Judaism, to the 80,000 fake religions and cults who came after. So I'm speaking a little bit about Christianity, a little bit about Islam, a little bit about Buddhism. So there's one Israeli guy with a ponytail, leather jacket. If I'm here, he's sitting maybe 10 feet from me. So as soon as I started to talk about the fake religions, he goes like this. Tachlif nose. Change subject. He goes like, change subject. So I say, look at this chatzuf, this arrogant guy. He's telling me what to talk about. I went full force now. Then he say to me, Amarti lecha tachlif nose. You change the subject. I go even stronger. After 20, 30 minutes that I speak about it, one big guy got up, took out the yarmulke, put it in a basket there, and got up like this. He said, that's it. I got nervous. I see this guy looks at me, the guy with the ponytail. I told you, change the subject. He got up. He said, if I'm going to stay here 10 more minutes, I'm going to have to convert. But they're gonna kill me in my village. I better run out before it will be too late. So I looked at him like this. I realized he's not a Jew. What was he? Druzi. But the Druze, since they're born in Israel, they grew up with Israelis like brothers. Their Hebrew, it's perfect Israeli Hebrew. You don't see, you never know. You see an Israeli guy, secular, and a Druze, you will never know that one is a Jew and one is not. Nowhere, nothing, there's nothing in the accent, nothing. They speak perfect Hebrew like the university, some of them. So how in the world I would know this guy is a Druzi? So then, as soon as he'd say that, if I'm gonna stay there, so one guy said to him, so stay, convert. So he said, if I'm gonna do it, my father will kill me. I can't do it to my father. 20 minutes I speak, he already got the point that he has to convert. Then from all the 150 people, who did he turn to scream it?
To Israel.
the guy that was trying to protect him. He said to him, you! tell the rabbi after this lecture where you're going tonight. This guy is, tell him, shame on you. He started to scream. I'm telling you, in effect, I wish there was film. Those days we didn't film lectures yet. He said, you have such a Torah, such a religion, and this is how you behave. He got up and left. The Druzi. I just spoke about him. It reminded me about him. Who knows? Maybe since then he converted already. So, now a soldier like this that died to protect the land of Israel, is he considered to be Hasid Umot HaOlam or not? Did you ever hear the expression of Hasidei Umot HaOlam? Hasidei Umot HaOlam, there are two kinds of people who fall into that category. Hasid means extra righteous. Umot HaOlam means the nation of the world. So the top VIP of the Goyim are called Hasidei Umot HaOlam. Remember this. Who fall into this category? A Gentile that keeps the seven laws of Noah. He loves God, is faithful to God, and fulfill his obligation in life as a goy. That automatically make him a righteous goy. And when he dies, he goes to heaven of the goyim. There's another category. A goy that risks his life to save Jews. Like in the time of the Holocaust, or when they made pogroms in Russia, or in the Arab countries. The Jew has plenty of pogroms, unfortunately. Some goyim used to risk their life hiding Jews in the attic. 2-3 years, they used to supply them with food. And some of them got caught and got killed by the Nazis for cooperating with the Jews. The question is, when a goy does such a thing, even if he didn't get caught, he got away with that. This goy automatically bought himself a big share for loving the Jews, for risking his life to protect the children of God. The question that I'm asking right now, it's not one of these two categories. There's one thing that you hide a Jew in your attic when they search for them to kill them, then one thing that you as a citizen of the land, you join the army because you are obligated. You get rights from the government, you also have obligations. Since you're a faithful citizen, they all go to the army. So the question is now, if he died in a war protecting the land of Israel, is he automatically considered to be Hasidei Umot HaOlam, or is just a goy who did something good, which Hashem will reward him for it? But doesn't mean that he goes to heaven because of that.
So goyim go to heaven anyway,
huh?
Goyim have heaven anyway.
The goyim has heaven, but I'm saying now, this is a goy that is not righteous, it doesn't keep the laws of Noah. Regular goy, not religious goy. Goy that joined the Israeli army, like a Russian goy. Russian, he eats pork every day. So the question is, because he died to protect Israel, is he automatically get now a share in heaven of the goyim because of that, and is falling into that category or not?
No,
it's
not. Yes, the second category. He risked his life for the Jews.
He was forced.
Before we answer this question, let's go one step further. Jews, Israelis, secular Israelis, who goes to the army, like you say, everyone has to go, you cannot get away with that. They are going to the army whether they like it, they don't like it, they are forced into it. Depends, everyone has his own feelings about it. And God forbid he died in a war while he's serving to protect the nation. But he wasn't Shomer Shabbat, was eating non-kosher, had a Polish girlfriend from Warsaw, he lived with her in Israel, or from Uganda, or from Thailand, or he's gay. There are plenty of those kind of soldiers. Some of the soldiers, they're anti-religion. Just because he goes to the army to fight to protect Israel as a country doesn't mean he has any connection to God. Many of them are proud to be atheists, Many of them make fun at Hashem and the Torah. Many of them attacked religious people in private events. Many of them write many horrible comments against God and the Torah. But he died faithfully to protect the land. Somebody like this is considered Arug Malchut, that he gave his life al Kiddush Hashem, and therefore he has a share to the world to come, even though he made many other horrible sins, that overcome his sins, because he gave his life for Kiddush Hashem, or no?
Yes. No. No. Goyim is right.
Yes.
That's the difference.
Let's not think with our heart. Let's think with our brain. If we think with the heart, we say yes, let him go. Yes. After all, he gave his life to protect the land.
Goy, yes.
Life is the most important thing in our religion.
No.
If you give your life to protect the country and other
doesn't people, matter. You this are can be a punishment for Mikhail.
Some people give their life for their team lost in a soccer game. And they go into a war, and they die. Okay. Or they kill people because of the score in a game. They also go to heaven.
The most valuable possession.
No. Someone who gave his life to go fight against the fans of the other team. He gave his life, and he got killed. Somebody stabbed him. So he also got to heaven because he was willing to give his life for his cause.
He just died for the land. He cannot be considered as a full tshuva. So he is not getting the place in heaven.
The answer. Let's give an answer.
So Jew doesn't get the place in heaven. And going
that's
the
place in heaven.
Correct.
Yeah, right. Okay, then let's give an answer. It's a controversial question, very. And many people will get angry on the answer, but we have to stick to the truth, not to our feelings, to the truth. The truth is, even though I heard some rabbis claim that they consider Arugei Malchut, that they metu al Kiddush Hashem, it's not true. It's not considered to down Kiddush Hashem. To down Kiddush Hashem means that the goy took you and he said, bow down to the statue, if not, we kill you. All you had to do is to go like this, and they let you go. And you say, I'm not going to bow down. Shema Yisrael, Hashem Elokeinu, Hashem Echad. Kill me. And they killed him. That's called metal kiddush Hashem. So even if he was secular, this Jew, he was secular, wasn't such a big tzaddik. But in a moment of a test, he gave his life to die, to sanctify the name of Hashem and the Torah. Then that's what the Gemara say, Yesh Adam kone olamo berega achad. There are people who buy eternity in one moment. Who? This example that I gave.
Because this is equal to tshuva. That's exactly what I said.
But someone who goes to the army because he has to go to the army because he's a citizen of the land, just like Americans go to the army and other countries, they go to the army. He goes to the army because if he doesn't go to the army, he goes to jail. There's no in between. Either army or jail, one of the two. You have to go. He went to the army, and then when there's a war, everyone goes to war. He has to go to war, whether he likes it, whether he hates it. Nobody asks him. He has to go to war. And he got killed in a war. Definitely, don't get me wrong, definitely he will get a huge reward or relief in his responsibilities about all the sins he made in his life, especially when he's so young. In Israel, you are 19, 20. That's a very young age. Definitely giving his life to protect other Jews would count as a very, very big mitzvah and a huge relief from any punishment that was due to him. But to come and make a statement, just because he died to protect the land, automatically he goes to heaven for eternity and he died on Kiddush Hashem, the answer is absolutely not true. Those who made this kind of speeches, they mislead the public. Maybe it's a wishful thinking. Maybe we follow our hearts because we love those soldiers who give their life for us. And of course we do, and we appreciate them, and we're grateful to them, and we hope they all return safe. There's no contradiction here. But we have to stick to the truth. We have to stick to the truth. I give you an example. 2 days ago, one goy that actually was very friendly with me for a long, long time, with back and forth with emails, also supporting CDs, very, very positive Gentile. And he heard my lecture that I gave to the ladies in Muncie about 10 days ago. And one Rebbetzin over there, she asked me a question in the end of the lecture about Lashon Hara, that we are not allowed to speak Lashon Hara about Jews, but is it allowed to speak Lashon Hara about non-Jews? So I told her, of course, it's not recommended to speak Lashon Hara about anyone. The question is, when do we get punishment for doing it and when not? That's the question. Not that it's a good thing to do, but if we speak about our brothers, the Torah say, Lo telech rachil be'amecha. Do not speak gossip, Lashon Hara, about people from your nation. Be'amecha. Okay? Or the Torah say, Lo tisna et achicha bilvavcha. Don't hate your brother in your heart, which means it's referring only to people from the Jewish nation. But when the Torah say you shall not kill, it didn't say you should not kill from your nation. You should not kill from your brother. You should not kill, period. That means you're not allowed to kill a goy. You kill a goy, a non-Jew, you are a complete murderer, just like when you kill a Jew. So therefore, there's no difference. The Torah say you should not steal. The Torah didn't say you should not steal from your brother. The Torah say you should not steal from anyone. You should not kidnap from anyone, not just Jews. You should not deceive, not only Jews, only non-Jews. You're not allowed to deceive them. But if you found a lost object, if it belongs to one of your brothers from the Jewish nation, you are obligated to return it. If it doesn't belong to your family, to the Jewish nation, you don't have an obligation to go and search for him. It's not your brother. The Torah did not require you to do the same efforts for strangers. Not that the Torah say he's garbage or he's not important. No, it's not your brother. I have a brother and I have a stranger sitting in yeshiva next to him. If I have to help one of them with X amount of money and I have only for one of them, who would I help? I help my brother, not the stranger. He's also a brother of mine. He's a Jew also. But there are priorities in life. Just because I have to help a Jew before I help a non-Jew doesn't mean the non-Jew is not important, but he's not my brother. Same thing among the Gentiles. They have to help their own people. So if a Korean guy has a test now to help his Korean brother from the same city, or an Israeli guy from Israel, and he went and helped his own brother, from his point of view, he did the right thing. I don't have the right to get angry. So this Gentile got upset. He wrote to me, is the goyim means, what was the words that he was using, a harsh word. The goyim means nothing, the goyim has no value like the Gentiles. So I said to him, after knowing me for so long, you should have known by now that I never mix my own opinions here. I only say what the Torah said and translate it, that's all. And I explained to him what's the difference between obligations to do it with your brothers or with strangers. Not that because you don't have to help the stranger, it doesn't mean that it's not important. And Baruch Hashem, after 2-3 emails back and forth, he got the point, and everything went back to normal. The idea is we should not act based on what the heart say. He acted as his heart, that's it. His heart got upset because he's a not Jew. And he reads in the Torah. Oh, so he asked me, where does it say in the Torah that the restriction is only from Jews against Jews? So I gave him the sources. Gave him a few sources. He got the point. He got the point. And by the way, not that it's recommended. Again, I said in the lecture there to this lady, better not to speak against anyone. What good is in it? First of all, it's only negative. Second, if you get used to it, then the next thing you begin to talk about your brothers, and the next day about the rabbis, and the next day about the chief rabbi, and the next day against Hashem.
No. The next step is about the prophet, and next Hashem.
Thank you. Thank you for pushing the prophet in.
You need the step.
Yeah.
That's what the Gemara says.
Now, a soldier that is married. Yes.
In a case when a person is asked to bow down to an idol, a Jew, but he doesn't know the law, What happens in that case to him?
It's considered
secular.
That's considered.
Where does he go?
That's considered like this. Listen, when a Jew doesn't know, a Jew that violates Shabbat not knowing, or worship an idol not knowing, it's a sin from the Torah, is considered b'shogeg. Therefore, if he got caught, he doesn't get execution. If the Beit HaMikdash exists, the Holy Temple, and they used to execute violators of Shabbat and idol worshippers, if this Jew said, I'm very sorry, I didn't know that he's not allowed to bow down to an idol. Nobody ever taught me. I didn't go to yeshiva. Nobody taught me. So they give him a warning, and they let him go. But he has to sacrifice korban chatat, sacrifice, special sacrifice for unintentional sins. However, if he repeats the sin again...
That's in Olam
Haba? No, here, in Beit HaMikdash. When Beit HaMikdash used to be, he used to go and sacrifice a special sheep for the actual, not intentional, violation of Shabbat. However, in order for him to make tshuva, he must receive suffering. That's why we suffer so much. When we do Isurei Karet, violation that the Torah says, and the soul will get cut out of my nation, God said, when we do repentance, it cannot be a complete repentance unless if we go to X amount of suffering. So what's the solution? The solution is to maneuver the suffering into mitzvot. Get up early in the morning, do chesed, volunteer, give a lot of tzedakah, pray longer, make all kinds of physical efforts for the keeping mitzvot and following Hashem. Why? The suffering that we're supposed to receive from our not intentional sins will be replaced with the suffering that we volunteer to receive. So in other words, you have a minyan next to your home at 8 o'clock, but you have another one at 6:30. You're not in a rush anywhere. You open your business at 10. You can pray at 8. But you say, Hashem, for you, I'm going to get up at 6, and I'm going to go to the 6:30. Freezing, snow, winds, you have to, you know. Fine, it's much harder than 8 o'clock, you know. Slept well already. So you do it. So Hashem deduct from the X amount of annual suffering that you deserve to get that was decided for you on Rosh Hashanah. So therefore, we have to be clever. How much suffering each one of us will get by weight was decided. How the suffering's gonna be, it's up to us. If I'm gonna run to do mitzvot and volunteer and help and bring guests and cook for them and change their sheets and take, you know, all kinds of things, do for others, visit the sick, help the poor, you know, running and giving CDs in college to Jews. Obviously, it requires effort. Hashem deduct all the suffering that I was supposed to get in, God forbid, sicknesses, problems at work, unemployment, humiliating interviews, etc. This is all get deducted because Hashem see that I'm willing to suffer for the sake of heaven. He deducts it from what I'm supposed to get. That's why it's very recommended to be Adam la'amal yulad, to put extra efforts.
But the secular person doesn't know that, what happens to him in this day and age.
He doesn't know. But when he finds out, he's still not knowing the rule doesn't say that you were dismissed from the punishment.
And if he doesn't find
but don't you consider it as the...
You know, if you drive in New York on a highway and it says 65 speed limit, and then you didn't realize, you get into a boot, you pay the toll, all of a sudden you're in Canada now. And now in Canada, it went down to 100 kilometers per hour. You didn't realize. You only will find out in 10 minutes until you see the first sign. And 100 kilometers, it's 55. You were driving 70. Now it's pulled you over. You're driving 15 miles faster than the speed limit. You say, what do you mean? It's 65. I drove 70. For that, you pulled me over? He said, no. You went not 5 over the limit, 15. And he gives you a juicy fine, $300. So now you say to him, but I didn't know, I really didn't know. I thought it's the same highway, I just saw a toll. There's many tolls, I didn't know. I'm just giving an example. Not knowing doesn't mean you're dismissed from the punishment. However, there's a discount. Instead of that penalty, he has to bring a sacrifice. That's all. Yes.
But how do you find out?
How you found out?
Somebody tells you.
You listen to the CDs. You search online. Before you buy an apartment, do you check 100 times? Wait. Answer. You check 100 times before you buy an apartment? Before you go into a partnership with a partner, you check 100 times? Why didn't you check 1,000 times? What's the purpose of your life?
But what
to make you think to check? It's required by common sense. Every secular Jew and non-Jew is required by common sense to search for God, to search for the creator of the world, to ask what's the purpose of life, and if he doesn't do it, that's what he's going to have to answer when he dies. Hashem will tell him, didn't you see what I did in the world? Didn't you see the order in the creation? Didn't you see what I have done for you personally? Didn't you see all the things that happened? How come you never search for me and never say thank you in your life?
Look at the news with the missiles. How many have missiles?
Yeah, just the fact that 2,000 rockets fell on Israel and nobody got hit directly by the rocket should have made every secular Jew in Israel run to the yeshiva. Rabbi, I have to talk to you.
Thank you very much.
Right, you got the point? Thank you very much. We'll see you next week. Thank you very much.